So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining the fifth event of the seminar series From Policy to Practice, Implementing the Marrakesh Treaty and Making Accessible Books Available. I'm Irene Kitsera from the Global Infrastructure Sector, and I will be the moderator of this side event to the 30th SECR. We are delighted to share with you the findings of the Patent Landscape Report on Assistive Devices and Technologies for Visually and Hearing Impaired Persons, which will be presented by Mr. Ed White. The report's presentation will be followed by examples of and experience with assistive technologies from our distinguished speakers and technical solutions that can facilitate access to published works and in generally positively impact and benefit persons with blindness or vision loss. Before that, let me give the floor to Mr. Yota Kagi, Assistant Director General of the Global Infrastructure Sector, for the welcoming remarks. Mr. Takagi, you have the floor.
Thank you, Irene Kitsara. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for coming. A warm welcome to you all to WIPO's side event of SECR, and this is the fifth seminar in support of implementation of Marrakesh Treaty. We have got the news that this morning, so we've got the nine countries that we are halfway through, that we have to start preparing for the implementation. And on the technical side, that this side event, I hope will help you understand that the technology and technological solutions on it, the assistive devices and technologies for visually and hearing impaired persons. Before giving the floor to Ed White, who represents the two co-authors of this publication, I'm sure you picked up a copy. This is a very thick book, the 171 pages. You are not supposed to read it through it. And so I'm sure that the Ed will share with us key findings in a few minutes. But before doing that, let me make a few introductory remarks to respond to a couple of obvious questions you may want to ask. What is Patent Landscape Report? And why WIPO is doing this? And what is the value of this publication? This is not the first publication. We have published a couple of several patent landscape reports in the past. And what did you make out of it, or what do we expect to see as a next step? So the first question is, what is patent landscape report? It's just a snapshot of technologies disclosed in a number of patents. Applications. So Ed will subsequently explain how many patent applications his team analyzed. It's tens of thousands of patent applications were published in the past in the domain of assistive devices and technologies in relation to visually and hearing impaired persons. So if you look at each patent application, it's something like you are looking at a tree. Yes, you can understand that particular technology disclosed in a patent application, but you can't tell the technological trends or where do we go from here. So you have to look at forest and a number of trees, tens of thousands of trees you have to look. And you have to map out those trees in a the map. So it's a snapshot of patent applications, but it's not only current snapshot, but also it covers all historic evolution of technologies. Some of them became obsolete, others are still relevant and waiting for commercial exploitation. But for unfortunate reasons, they are not able to find a commercial partner. Those technologies have to map out in the map. And so you have undulations, ups and downs, and then you have mountain or lake, or we are surrounded by mountains here. So mountains is the represented the high concentration of patent applications in higher altitude, I should say, or lake. There is no tree at all. So this is an area where research and development and activities are very, very few and almost non-existent. So this is presented in a visual way. But what's the use of presenting visual way to visually impaired persons? That's why we will make this publication available also in a format which is accessible by visually impaired persons as a demonstration of our firm commitment to a conclusion and signing of the charter for accessible publication in October last year. So WIPO will continue to commit to this publication in accessible format. So coming back to a question of patent landscape report, this is an analytical tool, so it is very much understandable for business people, the people who are interested in making investment in technological solutions, or people who are not really familiar with technologies but very much interested in commercial exploitation, or some people that may wish to start the political debate how those technologies which has never been commercially exploited should be encouraged to put down in reduced the practice by offering much more affordable device, assistive devices to the visually impaired person. So those debate we expect to happen could be triggered and prompted by this publication. Some inventors, individual inventors, you will see that there's a very high percentage of individual inventors who invented very good technologies and published in patent documents, but waiting for commercial exploitation. They are looking for partners. Business partnerships could be also encouraged and promoted by this publication. So this is a very good way of demonstrating and using the patent information and intellectual property system, which should contribute not only to the commercial interest, but also the other side or the other aspect of the intellectual property contribution to the enhancement of quality of our life. So this is dimension of the public policy objectives. So WIPO is very much keen on looking the use of patent information and also patent landscape in that context to promote the public interest. So this is our expectation, this is what we would like to encourage the stakeholders to use this patent landscape report. And this area is very, very difficult to analyze, as you will shortly hear from Ed. So we hope that these technological solutions already suggested by a number of inventors should be able to find a partner or business chance to make those assistive devices and technologies available in the market. The size of the market is huge. We have 300 million visually impaired persons, including 39 million blind people, and 360 million the people who are suffering from hearing impairment. So there's a huge market, potential market, and also here that there are a number of technological solutions out there. What we need is just to find the partnerships and make these technologies available for commercial exploitation, and we would see that much more that affordable assistive devices to help those people. So that is my introduction. And without further ado, I would like to invite Ed White, representing Thomson Reuters. Finally, I would like to thank all those panelists, guest speakers, for coming all the way and to contribute to this the fifth seminar in support of implementation of Marrakesh Treaty, which we hope that they enter into force in the near future. Thank you very much.
So unfortunately, my colleagues were based in Melbourne and Mumbai, so couldn't be here today. So I have been brought in to speak on their behalf. So first of all, I'd like to point out that the authors couldn't be here today. That was a very good introduction from Mr. Takagi. I think he's covered quite a few of the points that I would say in terms of what a patent landscape is. My presentation today is really to give you a flavour of what's inside this very big report. We are not going to cover, by any means, the majority of the conclusions that are in that report. But what I wanted to do was give you a flavour for what you can find out from the information, and also how it's structured, how this information is structured, so you can delve into it at your leisure. The way I'm going to do that is by focusing in on the technical innovations that we're seeing within this space, and then who the innovators are, both of which provide quite interesting information. And then at the end, I'll talk about a few of the key themes that I've highlighted in my presentation. There are a lot more inside the report itself. So just to give a bit of background on the project, Thomson Reuters has a services unit called IP Analytics, which I represent. I lead the IP Analytics unit for Europe. Our work is to produce this kind of information day to day, primarily for corporate customers who want to do technical intelligence, competitive intelligence, benchmarking, that kind of thing, looking at patent activity, also looking at other sources of scientific information, such as scientific literature. Our work with WIPO has been focused on demonstrating how patent landscaping can be used in some of the spaces that they're working on. And in this case, we're looking at the assistive area. So I should state, first of all, that this patent landscape is broader than just, let's say, the technologies covering that would implement the Marrakesh Treaty. Much, much broader. We are looking at both vision and hearing impairment, and then within that, we're also looking at both restorative devices and innovation, enhancement technologies, and assistive technologies. So everything from a speech, text-to-speech algorithm all the way up to a retinal implant or a cochlear implant. So we're quite holistic here. What we can find out from the information is really about what is being patented, what was being patented before, what is being patented now, looking at some of the changes in there, finding some quite interesting nuggets of information, which we'll point out. Also looking at who the active corporations are, or otherwise. And in fact, we have a fairly major data point that I think is substantive for this audience that we want to go through. And then finally, also looking at where innovation is coming from. One of the things that's unique about patents is that they are geographically distinct. A patent in Switzerland covers Swiss patents. You cannot then enforce your Swiss patent in the United States, for example. You would need a US patent in order to be able to do that. That makes patents quite geographical. They are geographical indicators as well, if that makes sense. And so we can look at where patents are coming from in terms of their patent offices to be able to distinguish Chinese innovators from American innovators from French innovators, for example. So I'm going to go a little bit further back and say, why look at patents at all? And why does Thomson Reuters run a service on this at all? Well, Thomson Reuters has a long-standing business in producing patent databases and scientific literature databases. However, our services group, if there was another data source that did what we did, we probably wouldn't worry too much about patents. I know that WIPO has a very large administrative function when it comes to the patent world. But our group, we don't really care about patents that much. We don't really care about the legal implications of patents. What we care about is the fact that they are commercial instruments. They are instruments that tie together very, very clearly the world of technology to the world of commerce. Each year, there is something in the region of $3 trillion US dollars spent on research and development. patents are probably one of the only ways of being able to tell what that $3 trillion was spent on, which makes it a pretty unique data source. We are going to apply that data source to a very specific question today. They also cost quite a lot of money to obtain. Standard rule of thumb is that a granted US patent will cost you around $10,000. If you want the same invention also protected in Europe, you're talking at $20,000 to $30,000. And then more countries you add, the pricier it's going to get. That is an axis of investment that we're going to use today. But it means that we have multiple sort of analytical techniques to get into this data: technology, commerce, and investment. So here is patents associated with vision and hearing impairment, restoration, enhancement, and assistance. On your infographic, it tells you that there are 35,000 patents. That's true. I think it's either just over or just under 35,000 patents. That is just under 9,000 unique inventions. And I just want to describe those two numbers for you. Because you can file the same invention in multiple territories, we have more patents than we have inventions. This study, from this slide onwards, is only going to deal with inventions, not patents. So just be clear up front. Of those 9,000, there's a fairly clear trend, I think you'd say, in terms of how many are occurring each year, with around a third of those inventions having been filed in the last 5 years. There is an interesting data point at the end in the most recent years of data from about 2008, which is due to a very specific geographic trend. The United States is the principal source of innovation in hearing and vision impairment, and that has been the case pretty much up until this year. Next year, China will be the largest source of innovation in hearing and vision impairment. If you look at those two lines on the chart, the right, they're about to cross. China is currently third. I expect it to be second or first in the coming years in terms of the overall number of cumulative patents. This means that Europe and the US has traditionally been the source of innovation in this space. That innovation source is diversifying quite rapidly in this field. I do want to point something out, though, that this is by no means unique to hearing and vision technology. This chart on the right is a chart that I create every week for any technology area that I look at, whether it be mining, whether it be industrial chemicals, whether it be mobile telephony. China has this output. And it is an interesting, difficult problem to get our head around, which is there is so many patents being filed by Chinese patent applicants that everybody in every industry is trying to work out whether it's important or whether it's not important. And I'm pretty sure exactly the same issue is occurring in the WIPO patent examiner core as they deal with the volumes coming from China. We are able to look at the patents that are being filed and figure out whether they are important or whether they are less important. And one of the ways we can do that is using that axis of money that we were talking about earlier on. The more countries you file in, the more expensive the process gets. So what we look at here is we look at the average number of countries that invention has been protected in by the source country of that invention. And we've also put the volume in there so that you can understand outlier statistics as well. So the one that I would focus on is the European Patent Office is, I think it's the third or fourth largest source of patents in this field. And on average, a patent filed first in Europe, probably from a European entity, is filed in a further two territories. Get that right, further two territories. Probably the United States and probably one other. Compare that to China. At the bottom, 2,688 separate inventions in here, but on average filed in 1.1 territories, which means they're filed in China and China alone. What this tells us is that commercialization of patented technologies in hearing and vision is predominantly going to come from the countries at the top of that list. It's going to come from markets that traditionally have been the source of these. It is less likely to come from the countries at the bottom of that list: Russia, China, Taiwan, and Japan, which is a surprising one, I think. So now we're going to go into a bit deeper into the technologies themselves. And Mr. Takagi was talking about where the peaks are in technology within our landscape. This is a visualization technique that's called concept mapping. It's actually specifically called themescaping. What it basically does is we throw 9,000 inventions at this algorithm. It reads all the text in them, and it tells you where there are common concepts, common phrases occurring with the same frequency in different documents. Where that phrase occurs in lots of documents, there is a white mountain of density around that. So you can see, for example, top left-hand corner, there is a peak called implant processes. Lots of documents share that terminology, and therefore it groups around it. What we've then done is we've then drawn over the top of this map to show you where the primary sort of subject matter is in terms of our analysis. We have, I've called it three major topics. It's probably six major topics. We've got hearing and vision restoration, hearing and vision enhancement, and hearing and vision assistance. But those six buckets then fall into sub-technologies that we're going to look at in a lot more detail. So things like speech and text technology, things like ocular implants, electrical stimulation, hearing aids, mobility assistance, and many others that you'll see in here, for example, tactile braille technologies. But this essentially is a way of saying, what are these 9,000 patents about that have been filed in the last 30, 35 years? So looking at the trends at a high level, what we have here is four charts that look at vision and hearing restoration in green, vision and hearing assistance in blue, enhancement in yellow-orange, and then we have a fourth bucket, which is what we've called additional technologies, and that is one that we're going to go into in a little bit more detail, but they're essentially technologies that could be applicable to all three, or to both vision and hearing at the same time. So it's things like hardware, software, disposable devices, and a couple of others. And in particular, the access to published works subject matter that we're going to talk about. When you look at these, you can see that in assistive and enhancement technologies, the volumes we're seeing with vision and hearing are actually quite closely aligned, showing that these markets are probably relatively tied together. That relationship between hearing and vision really breaks down in terms of restoration technologies, where you can see that hearing restoration, this is the bright green line in the top left, hearing restoration is at a fairly low level compared to vision restoration. And that tells us that hearing restoration has a product that's already on the market that you will see in this landscape, which is the cochlear implant. That product, not quite on the market yet for vision restoration. I'm almost certain it's on its way in the next couple of years in terms of retinal implants and intraocular devices and the like. But there is a lot of innovation going into that space right now. So is an interesting area. But in general, fairly lockstep hearing and vision, except for that restorative area. That's the trends from 1990. Now we look at trends in the very recent period, in the last 5 years or so. Again, we have our high-level subject matter areas that we're looking at. Those that are to the left have, on average, declined since 2008. Those that are to the right have, on average, grown since 2008. We know that growth since 2008 has primarily been a Chinese phenomenon from our chart earlier on. And indeed, that's borne out that when you look at the areas that are growing, particularly in vision assistance, which is a subject matter that is specifically interesting to this audience in terms of technologies associated with the Marrakesh Treaty, it is the fastest growing area right now across all of these fields. And more of it is coming from China than is coming from the United States. So there is some interesting changes going on in that space. And in fact, when you look at it, a quarter of that 10% growth is Chinese, just under a quarter is the US, and between them they make up half of the whole field. So that's pretty interesting. Another way of looking at this information, you can see that we're combining together here tech, time, and countries as a way of describing what we're looking at. Another way of looking at the information is looking at our top countries as sources of innovation across these high-level subject categories. And you can see, for example, the United States has a very strong interest in vision restoration. And in fact, when you look at the US, it all appears to be mostly vision-related rather than hearing-related, which in itself is quite interesting. But when it comes to the hearing side, that is more clustered from Japan, Germany, South Korea, and more generally, Europe. There are a couple of things that I wanted to point out, which was that 33% in the additional related technology for the United States, the top second from right box on the chart, on the table, from the United States, that bucket is the area that we have for access to published works and a couple of other technologies. So we're going to look at that in a bit more detail. This slide is really to introduce you to the amount of technical data that's inside the report. Those seven or eight buckets of technologies is really just the tip of the iceberg of how far down the rabbit hole we go in terms of looking at these technologies. So as an example, you can see that within enhancement, within vision, we then have things like image encoding, display of information. These are topics that are probably really interesting to you. They are enabling technologies for things like text-to-speech and speech-to-text and so on. And you can see down in our additional technologies, we have access to published works hearing, access to published works vision, disposable limited use, design shape, hardware, software, and so on. This slide is really to tell you that this level of information is available in the report. We're going to look at a few of these in a bit more detail. The other thing that's interesting about this is that bar chart that runs down the side. If you want a quick snapshot of where most patented technology sits, it'll be the long bars. If you wanted to know where there are gaps in the current patent landscape, it is the ones with short bars. You can run through that at your leisure. So we've been talking about technology trends, and what I want to do now is show you a technique that we use in order to be able to confirm, sort of use multiple pieces of evidence in order to confirm whether a technology trend is occurring or not. And the way that we do that is to look at, obviously, volumetric growth in patent output, but also to have some understanding of the commercial relevance or the quality or the level of investment of the patents that were filed. We have at Thomson Reuters, we have a measurement that we call the Invention Strength Index, which is based on how many countries is it filed in, how many times is it granted and where did it grant, how often is it cited downstream, how young is it or old is it, whether it's maintained, and so on and so on and so on. All of that is wrapped up into a model called the Invention Strength Index. Then we have taken all of the patent documents in each of the technologies and found the average Invention Strength Index, which is the x-axis on this chart. That is then arrayed against the proportion of activity in each of those technologies that's occurred in the last 5 years. So if there are two patents in a field and one was filed in 2011 and one was filed in 2007, it would be a level of 50% filed recently. We then look at the convergence of those two factors. So we are looking specifically for high quality, strong patents that are being filed recently in these technology areas. And those technologies are now listed on the top right-hand side. All of them, effectively, are emerging technologies. Low volume, in most cases, but we have confirmatory evidence that whoever it is that is applying for these patents is doing so in a committed manner. Some of the most interesting that we've got on here are electrical hearing stimulation. That is a field, again, that is very well known. There are products on the market for. There is obviously continued investment in here. Probably the most interesting one for me is the disposable technology and also biodegradable technology for hearing and vision implants. What this tells me is that the market is moving towards commoditized devices. If you have a throwaway hearing aid, that is very different from a hearing aid that today will cost you $4,000 or $5,000. And what that does is that opens up technologies that exist today at high-end, high-cost prices to a much larger group of users later on. The fact that we can see evidence that the technical innovation in this space is moving towards disposable devices, that's probably quite an exciting idea. in terms of what we're talking about. Take with that on top that trend from China, a country which knows a thing or two about mass production. This could be quite an exciting trend. And then the other one that I thought was quite interesting was on the vision enhancement side, which was about color brightness enhancement of images. And this is effectively taking visual information and probably making it in a way that would be disturbing to somebody with normal vision, but quite useful to somebody with partial vision so that they can see it more clearly. That is also one of the technologies that we're seeing. Together with a few other pieces of information, advanced software algorithms for most of the items that we're talking about here, image encoding, display of information and so on, is almost guaranteed to be a field of growth. So now I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about the access to published works technical area. The first thing I'm going to say is that this is a really, really difficult area to define well in the data set that we've put together. And there is probably a really simple reason for that. Our landscape looks at vision and hearing impairment effectively. Probably most of the technology that's used for what we're talking about here doesn't really care that much about blind, deaf individuals. It's in your mobile device already, it's just not being used for that technology. So if you think about Siri, if you think about Google Text, if you think about machine translation tools, if you think about optical character recognition technologies, all of these are technologies that are relevant to what we're talking about here, but don't have a patent application that said that this is really useful for somebody with a vision impairment. So that's our first sort of definition. The other thing that I can tell you that there is something wrong with the data sources that we're looking at is that there is more on the hearing side than there is on the vision side. That's pretty suspect, I think, actually. I know that there will be innovation in terms of creating audio information in a visual format for the hearing impaired, but I suspect it's not as big as what we would see for technologies for the vision impaired. However, we're going to give it a go anyway and delve into what we can find out. And so I'm going to not look at the hearing side because I'm suspicious about its accuracy. I'm going to look at the vision side and go into a little bit more detail. And so what we've got here is a list of those enabling technologies, those sub-technologies that are specifically in the access to published works. So we have got a very big peak around software for the display of information. We would expect that. That's a technology area that we would want to see. A subset of that would be image encoding, so that would include text-to-speech. It would also include some form of audio description of diagrams or some translation of pictorial information into sound. And we have a very big peak around tactile technology, haptic technology, that would be specifically Braille. Some of the ones that are, again, we see that recency peak, very, very low level of documents, but for color brightness enhancement. So that would be more an enhancement technology than an assistance technology. The thing that is incredibly interesting about this is the entities that are patenting in this access to published works vision space. And that's the table on the right. When we look at patent information, we spend a long time cleaning up who the entity is that owns the patent today. It's a process that's actually really laborious, particularly when you look in sort of tech areas like communications, because the name that's on the front page of the patent is the name of the company as it existed the day it filed the patent. Just to give an example of how complex this can be, Cisco Systems, as a company, used to buy 50 companies a year. So all the patents that are associated with every single one of those 50 companies now has the wrong name written on the front of it. So what we do is we go through a whole process of aggregating all that information together. And one of the ways we do that is we look at the inventors' names and see if they occur on different companies. If they don't occur with something associated with the company, we stick them in a bucket called individual inventors. So this is probably, not certainly, but probably a patent coming from somebody who did it on their own time, in their own, without the support of an employer. In the access to published work space, the top inventor is those individual inventors. And that implies that this is not a commercial field yet. It implies that this is, I've called it a cottage industry. I don't know if that's a little bit too subjective. but it implies that this is a field that is, that big companies are not yet investing lots of money in, which may be a problem. This looks like a commercialization barrier. This looks like an issue. Where there is a top company, it's IBM with 41 patents, obviously a big software developer. IBM is also, half the company is making money out of its products and services. Half the company is effectively a primary research institution. They patent and do a lot of primary research themselves, so that's quite interesting. How I know, however, that this is some information that we can take to the bank is actually who the other applicants are. We have Hewlett-Packard and Xerox. These are both imaging companies who definitely will have technologies that are applicable to this space. And the other company that's interesting in there is Freedom Scientific, which is a small company that is specifically marketing products that enable access to books and so on. So this is a sort of qualified list. This is a good list, but something weird is going on here. There isn't a company at the top of their list. There is a whole bunch of individual people who are filing for protection, some of whom are sat to my left at the moment, so it's just quite interesting. Okay. So I'm just going to quickly go through who the innovators are. One of the things that we always look at is the proportion of patents that are coming from academia. Universities file for patents when they want to transfer technology from their research into the real world. In this case, about 8% of patents are coming from academia, which is high. Normally, it's around 3, 4%. So we know that this is a field that needs academic collaboration. In terms of a potential reason why, and we're going to validate this later on, we think that's because that this is a field that requires a lot of interdisciplinarity working. You need engineers and you need biochemists and you need, you know, etc. to work together in order to solve these problems. That's why academia is probably involved. One of the things that we can look at when we look at academia, universities tend to file for patents on more basic technologies, corporations on more applied technologies. The reason they work together is to make the link between basic to applied. Where we see lots of academic activity in our technology tree, we're looking at where the next gen items are coming from, where the research is needed in order to further the next 5 years worth of technologies will be coming from, if I can get my words out. We've labelled those in green. What's interesting about them is that they cluster around vision and not around hearing, which is interesting. And when they cluster, in particular, I think there's one that's quite interesting, which is around vision electronic stimulation. Those are technologies that would be related to retinal implants. So we can imagine that that is still a very basic technology. There are some really cool stuff going on in that space, but it is requiring that interface between technology and medicine. And so you can imagine the number of disciplines that are involved in there are quite require this academic level. In terms of where the countries are that are most of this academic activity is coming from, those are highlighted in light blue, with high proportions of the patents from South Korea, Russia, and China coming from academic institutions. Indicate potential sources of more fundamental science in this space. Bear in mind that the volumes for those different countries vary enormously. So China is quite high on this list because its volumes are much greater than that of South Korea and Russia. And then finally, we're going to start looking at the major patent portfolios across the whole landscape. The top applicant is a pharmaceutical company, Novartis, primarily looking at intraocular devices. The thing about this list, we were talking about interdisciplinarity. This is a list of widely varying industries. We have telecommunications companies, we have medical devices companies, we have pharmaceutical companies, and we have an academic institution from Russia in the top 10. The most sort of commercial portfolios we see in here, where we see convergence between the invention strength and the recency, those two rightmost columns, are Cochlear and Advanced Bionics. Those two companies go head-to-head in the cochlear implant space. So they are, we can kind of qualify our information saying those companies are selling a viable medical device product for the restoration of hearing at the moment. Cochlear, fortunately, is a case study company for Thomson Reuters, so I can talk about them. We work for them quite a lot. helping them navigate this space. So, key themes. This is a really diverse field. That's partly because we looked at it quite a diverse way. It's a field that requires collaboration. It's growing very quickly, particularly in China. But when we look at the sort of commercial potential, the products are probably likely still to come from the Western market. When we look at the companies that are there, Novartis, Nuance, which is a really interesting speech processing company, Cochlear, Abbott Labs, Panasonic, Johnson & Johnson. Some of the more fundamental science, however, may come from Asia, that higher level of Chinese academic patenting. The growth in disposable devices is really interesting, potentially looking at low-cost commoditization of previously expensive devices. What that does is, of course, is quite interesting, because it opens up current market in terms of high-tech devices to a much wider base, but what it also does is it moves all of those companies that were producing those high-cost devices into the next product development phase. They're going to have to come up with something else, because everyone's going to sell their product at low cost. And then in terms of using academic patent activity to indicate where the next generation of technology is going to come from, as well as combining that with our analysis of emergent technologies, the next leaps in this field that are likely to happen are advanced software for encoding visual or oral information. In particular, there was a point about enhancement for partially affected people, persons, but also the complete translation from one medium to the other, or vice versa, for blind deaf individuals. And then the second one, which is almost certainly going to happen, is further advances in implants for the restoration of vision. The restoration of hearing, it's already there, I'm sure it will get better and better, but the retinal implant space has not yet happened in a big way, but it probably is about to happen, which is quite interesting. And that's it. I will open it up to questions, and thank you for listening.
Thank you, Ed. I would suggest, are there any questions related to this presentation? Because I would suggest to move forward with the next presentations to then, oh, please.
Yeah, yes, sir. Have you found any evidence of patent thickets in the area of assistive technologies?
Patent thickets, sorry, did you say patent thickets?
Yeah, that's what I asked. For example, when people have presented patent landscapes, for example, in the area of green technology, one of the questions that people often ask.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I was saying that in the area of like green technology, people will try and sort of look at the patent landscape in different kinds of technology, like batteries, for example, or in some other areas, and try and figure out if there are areas where the patents create a problem in terms of the competitive supply of something, and whether they have to think about patent exceptions. And in the assistive technology, I've never seen anybody kind of look at it. I know that my mother is a cochlear implant user, and I know that there's a lot of people have been concerned about the pricing. I know South Africa, for example, the World Health Assembly really had a lot of concerns about the pricing of cochlear implants, which seemed odd to me because it was basically an invention that first came out a really, really long time ago. And I'm surprised that the prices are as high as they are for something like that, and so basically inaccessible in developing countries. As you know, that's a remarkable technology for people who are deaf. But just in general, I just wonder if you ran across any of these, if you were able to answer any questions about the relative relationship between the patent landscape on assistive technology and whether or not there are any sort of monopoly-type problems in that area or patent thicket problems.
Yeah, sure. So one of the analysis, I'm fairly certain it's in the report, one of the analysis we do look at is that long list of technologies we've got by company. So you'll be able to see, for example, whether you know Novartis has taken a really strong position in a specific space. You will be able to see it. That's not to say that the thicket's any good, but we have other metrics in there that will tell you that. It is possible to use the information that we have published, because all of the scores are there, all of the technologies are there, all of the companies are there, to be able to understand that, for example, within cochlear implants, does advanced bionics have a specific set of patents around power supplies, for example, where that would cause the issue. Yes, you can see that information within it. Have we identified them? I think we've shown them. I don't think we've talked about them that much, but that information is there.
So is there a point when you're going to be able to talk about them? Because I mean, when you say you showed them, I mean, some of this is a bit hard for, it's like getting information like a fire hose, you know, in terms of the amount of data that you presented. So, you know, if you could just find some time to kind of talk about what you've shown in that particular niche would be cool.
We'll exchange business cards. We'll have a conversation about it. No problem.
Well, again, we should distinguish the patent portfolio to the thickets, because it could it is an indicator, but it's not a proof. So I think this one should really look into the various parameters before jumping into this conclusion. So thank you very much, Ed, for a very informative presentation. And since this seminar series is pretty much related to the practical implementation of the Marrakesh Treaty, let us now move to concrete examples, or not.
Yeah, the number that you quoted that you found surprising about private inventors on vision enhancing technologies is not so surprising. The blind community has long embraced by themselves, what you said, it's a cottage industry of that has embraced since the last 20 years sort of the self-help idea or possibilities of computer technologies. And the additional reason for that there are so many inventors, is that being a blind person doesn't really make it easy for you to find a job. So these people took matters in their own hands.
It's a very good point.
Students. Students like to make their master thesis on blind.
I will actually say, actually, that in terms of medical devices in general as well, you get a lot of doctors who file patents in their own name as well. So it occurs in a couple of different medical device fields as well. So yeah, it's interesting.
So let us now see some of the examples of the technical categories that Ed mentioned before that were identified in the report. And let us start with Mr. Alvin Cook. Alvin is the International Sales Director at HIMSS International Corporation and is based in South Korea. Alvin will talk to us about HIMSS solution for facilitating access to published works, and also some HIMSS initiatives to assist with making accessible books available. Alvin, you have the floor. Thank you.
Book from Korea, and today I present HIMSS International, a manufacturer and developer of assist technology product for the visually impaired. Today I'll show you how assist technology product can assist the visually impaired to access books and information and in alternative formats and to perform professional work. Before I move to our main topic today, I want to briefly introduce our company first. We were originally developing a military program for Ministry of Defense in Korea. And one day, by chance, we were asked by a teacher from a school for the blind to develop a note taker for his blind student. And as you can see, there were no such device available at that time. As this our motivation, we started developing our first Braille sense note taker, which actually took almost 5 years to get the first actual commercial sample. And after that, we have been introducing new technology and new ideas to the market and to the industry for the last 15 years. The first blind student who used our first Braille sense note takers are adult now, and they are actively engaged in many fields. Our company goal is to provide the visually impaired with equal access to the same information as their classmate or coworkers, and to help them to achieve their academic and professional goals. There are many different kind of solutions and products for the visually impaired, but our company is focused on and specialized in braille note taker and braille display for the blind, and portable desktop and handheld magnifiers for the low vision, and OCR multimedia player for both. One of the biggest obstacles for the blind student and professionals is to obtaining equal information, the same information as their sighted classmate and coworkers. This success has two parts. First, the material must be in a format that is accessible to the blind. That means they should be able to both read and navigate it easily. The second, the blind must have the devices available to them for reading and navigating. The material is kept in its specialized and accessible format. As you know very well, the organizations like WIPO and through agreement like Marrakesh Treaty, they are largely responsible for ensuring the legal availability of accessible materials. And the organizations like ABC, Accessible Book Consortium, and Electric Libraries all around the world are chiefly responsible for producing, distributing books, newspapers, and other published works in accessible formats in various languages. And accessible formats include the DAIGI or electronic braille or emerging formats like EPUB3. The goal of our product is to make access to this information simple and efficient. Whether the user is a student in a classroom or a professional in the workplace or somebody trying to read a book on vacation or elder people who can no longer read printed books or newspapers. This page shows how the materials and information originally produced for the sighted people should be changed to accessible format for the blind using technology. Among those, I will introduce two of our products as examples. First, this is a DAIGI player. There are a range of devices for obtaining reading accessible electronic materials. DAIGI player, like our blade, as you can see on the screen, is a simple on-the-go solution for non-technical users that allow the playback of audio material or reading and navigation of text-based material via text-to-speech engine. These devices are often targeted toward the newly blind or senior population with simple and tactile buttons. Most of those devices has built-in Wi-Fi capability and thus allowing direct search and download from accessible electronic libraries. For example, Blade Easy lets the user search, download, and read material from Bookshare, Online Digital Library, and other libraries, such as National Library Service in the USA and Nota Libraries in Denmark. Download is quick and very simple, even for the non-technical user. Please watch a video to actually know how actually it works.
So I'm placed on my Bookshare download application in the Library Services menu on my Blaze EZ. So I'll just press select to open it.
Bookshare ID. jackslowone@gmail.com.
And my login information is already entered, so I'll arrow up.
Login.
And I'll press select to login.
Login success. Search mode. Book.
Now I have three search modes. I can search for books.
Periodical.
Periodicals.
History.
Or history. And I'll just arrow down.
Results. 14th Deadly Sin, one of 12.
And it gives me the list of books in my history, or rather the list of books that I have downloaded in the last 30 days. This is a very easy way for someone to actually make something easily available for someone else. For example, an elderly person's daughter or son could put this in their history, and then the person could easily log in with their Blaze EZ and just download it. So I'll press select here.
Detail dialog. Download book.
And I have two options. I can download the book.
Book information.
Or I can get book information. I'll arrow back to the left.
Download book.
And press select on download.
Download complete. Open.
And it's that easy. The book was downloaded, extracted, and the book reader automatically opened, so the person can automatically start reading.
So you can see on the screen that there are several buttons, and each buttons are dedicated for each feature. So if you want to listen to music, you press just one button. So it's very easy to use. And this is a device for the elderly and non-technical user. Now like this, with the Age Player, we also have Braille Note Taker. Braille Note Taker is a tablet-like device for the blind. Instead of utilizing a touch screen, these devices use Braille or QWERTY keyboard for input and provide output in speech and Braille. They originally contain a full suite of Braille-based application for document creation, organization of contact and appointment, and social networking, media and entertainment, web searching and browsing, GPS and navigation, and of course accessible book search and download. Not like a previous Age Player, Note Taker is for students and professionals because with this Braille. As opposed to speech only, this Braille contributes to literacy by giving students a pitch curve, active method for making an information, and allowing them to view spelling, formatting, and etc. And also, one of the good things to have Braille is you can read very silently in the classroom or during the lecture, which means they can completely participate more efficiently in those activities. This seems Braille sense, and just like our Braille also has access to Bookshare, Online Age, and other electronic library services. Users can then use our Braille sense to read books aloud or scroll text-based material in Braille. I also want to show you how the blind poor people.
I'm now in the Extras menu of my BrailleSense U2 Mini, and I'm placed on the Bookshare download application, so I'll press Enter to open it.
Connected, please wait.
And now it's connecting, and it's going to go ahead and log me in. My login information is saved, so it'll automatically do that for me.
Select search mode, books, combo box.
And again, I can select books.
Periodicals, history.
Periodicals are history. This time I'll do a quick search.
Books. Select search method. Search word. Combo
I
box.
I can actually search word.
Category search. Combo box.
Or I can do a category search. I'll search for a word, so I'm going to move back.
Search word. Search word. Enter title, author, or ISBN. Edit box.
And we'll just search for Harry Potter. Everybody knows Harry Potter.
Harry.
And I'll press search enter. It.
Harry Potter's bookshelf 184. List item.
And again, I can just move through my list.
Harry Potter Collector's Handbook 284. List item. Harry Potter and Philosophy 384. List item.
And I'll press enter just to download it.
Preparing download.
And it's going to go
download
ahead
started.
And download it. It says download started.
5 second download done. Harry Potter and Philosophy 384. List item.
And it placed me back in my book list. If I had used my tab key or my F3 key, I could have gone through various items such as getting book information and also setting options. I can set it to auto unzip, I can set where I want it stored, and then I can use the Daisy Player to actually read the book. What's really great about that is that a student can also use the buttons here on the front to control a Daisy textbook and take notes with the keyboard on the top in the word processor.
Okay. So as I have demonstrated, there are tools to access the information, and there's a legal ground through treaties like Marquesi and through accessible electronic libraries. So in the perfect world, the blind people should be able to access any material, any books or a newspaper, any information easily, as we showed through the video. But in the real world, actually, the blind users do not have easy accessibility to reading materials in forms they can use. So many of the barriers still remain, and they are mainly related to the performance, organization, infrastructure, and cost. As a provider of assistive technology product, we often find ourselves faced with the challenges of supporting a variety of unfamiliar and proprietary promise. Often each library also has its own individual protection system as well. Communication with the international provider can also be a challenge for us. And in many more countries, there simply are not accessible electronic libraries in existence. First, there must be an organization who is charged with or has the motivation to do the work of developing the electronic library system. This may include digitalizing information previously created in other format, as well as this kind of organization should provide new material as well. These organizations must also create and maintain a centralized electric book and regulate access to only those with the legal necessity of using accessible format. And next, the infrastructure. There should be infrastructure within the country to allow available and affordable internet access for the blind users. And finally, the cost. Normally, the assistive technology product is more expensive than the ordinary people can afford. So if there's no governmental or organizational funding to assist them to purchase this technology, probably they don't have any other way to obtaining and acquiring information. HIMSS is committed to support access to books, news, and information for users around the globe. So as you can see, our product currently supports all accessible electronic libraries in many countries, and including the Bookshare, which is available in more than 52 countries. We are also in discussion with organizations with other countries, encouraging their efforts to secure regulations for accessible materials in their countries, electronic libraries development, and of course, user access through accessible technology. So, if any of you are aware of any online library service which we are not supporting, or that are currently under construction, or any organization which may be interested in working with us to provide accessible reading devices to blind or visually impaired, please feel free to let us know. Thanks for your attention, and sorry for the trouble getting your video.
Thank you so much, Alvin. So let us now take a look at a technical solution that comes from India, Mr. Sumit Dagar. Sumit is an awarded designer, inventor, and entrepreneur who will share with his experience with us and the challenges that an individual inventor, like we saw in the results before, is facing when moving from patenting or developing a prototype to commercialization. Thank you, Sumit.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Sumit Dagar. As I mentioned, I'm the founder at Create. Basically, we take a design and technology-led approach towards creating accessible solutions. Primarily, we have been working for visually impaired till date, but the vision is to help other disabilities as well with technologically innovative products which are designed in a user-centric way. Since we are talking about our products are visually impaired, I'll go back to this chart. This was sort of like our inspiration for starting work in this field. This is basically a comparison of features that are provided for visually impaired since mobile phones have started coming in. So when mobile phones came in as a keypad-based phones with really less features, they were almost equally accessible for sighted and for non-sighted. And as we started advancing with mobile phone technologies, they first became smartphones with keypads. So they were also like in the mid zone. They were also accessible since they had keypads and they were primarily OS-based phones, not app-based phones. And then towards the end, when we reached the iPhone era, It was more of a touch-based devices that these phones were, and they were third-party apps on these devices. So what happened at this point was the accessibility of mobile phone went really low because all the interface was based on visual feedback and all the input was based on touch. So there's not really any direct feedback apart from speech. So this is the area where we try to concentrate on. We try to provide accessible solutions on mobile platform for visually impaired. I'll just run through some of our works which are more more commercial, more out in the market than cover one of our concept products. This is an app called Simply. It's a custom designed personal assistant app. It is basically, it provides all the features of a feature phone on a smartphone in a very accessible way, on a touch screen based phone, in a very, very accessible, very, very simple way. It works using gestures and provides almost all the typical features of smartphone. The other app, it's called 7 Braille. It's a typing keypad keyboard for, again, touch devices. So instead of a QWERTY keyboard that we usually have for any typing scenario, this keyboard allows a visually impaired person to use Braille and type almost as fast as sighted people can on touch screens, which is sort of a big leap, big revolutionary leap for them. The concentration of my today's talk is the Braille phone project, where we basically started Create with. It was a tactile smartphone for visually impaired. It's supposed to be like an ideal device for visually impaired. It basically works on a technology which pops up images, pops up data from a touch screen. So it's basically a grid of pixels, with each pixel which can move in the third dimension, basically up and down. So in a grid of such pixels, it can form patterns which a non-sighted person can touch and feel. So basically, they can feel shapes, they can feel text, they can feel textures and stuff like that. So this was the primary basic technology that we based it on. And then it had a lot of features, all based on feeling the interface rather than seeing the interface. So features such as music or games, keyboard, navigation maps, and translate. Translate is, it captures something in the camera and converts that textual information into Braille information. Anybody can, any non-sighted person can read that on the interface. And does the similar thing for images or videos, basically like a height map of anything that's visual. As we started working on this in more detail in terms of implementation, we zeroed it on version 1 product, which just did the textual part of it, not a continuous grid, but rather, this is called refreshable Braille display, rather a grid of characters which can show Braille information. So we went through quite a lot of iterations with this in terms of prototypes, both design prototypes, which was more of ergonomics, and technical prototypes, which was more of electronics and feasibility of such product. And did a number of user studies with users to understand their experience part of it, in terms of, it does it really make it easy for them to do the task that we imagine them to do? And also in terms of features, that does it give the same level of superpowers as sighted people get through smartphones. These were the prototypes we ended up with. The front two are the electronic versions, which are working versions, which work as a smartphone. And on the top, the white area is the refreshable Braille display. So that displays all the information in Braille. There's obviously voice feedback as well, but that was like the primary source of display. So we, unfortunately, this was like the end of this project. By this time, we realized that it's, first of all, it comes out as a costly device. And secondly, the market is not mature enough to understand the potential of such device to like organizations to support such sort of research, semi-commercial product. So this was sort of the end of the project as such. Our learnings from this was, first of all, this I was talking to Ed as well, there's not enough market research in the field. We know the holistic numbers that these many braille, these many visually impaired people are there, even geographically, the distribution, but not a refined market research in terms of what's the literacy level, what's the economic background, what's the technical acceptance of these people. So it's hard to get more stakeholders who have a direct interest in any particular, you know, subsection of the field, apart from government as such, which is more more generic. It is, secondly, it is also a very nascent market. I think Ed was saying the same thing. There's not enough commercial products in this. I say this in terms of context of mobile solutions. There's not enough products which we can benchmark it, develop some sort of standard, some sort of understanding which makes it easier to provide standard solutions and then enhance the experience. Thirdly, we realize mobile has a lot of potential. It we say mobile can be the new desktop, but the idea is that it, as it has turned out to be for sighted people as well, it provides so much flexibility in terms of features it provides and the portability it provides. Same thing can be implemented for visually impaired, but again, I mean, it's not yet there. Scale is the primary goal. Again, this is sort of common for anything social social. To create impact, you actually have to reach a scale. But the positive part of it, if you are creating something that can reach a scale, if it is scalable, then stakeholders come in more easily because they realize if they support, then it can actually help at a global stage. So instead of, say, distributing X amount of devices in a particular geography, if I'm rather creating like a software solution or a product which can scale around the globe, it becomes, it is more readily acceptable from various stakeholders. This room for collaborative work across the globe, there's, I think, as we see, we work in our own silos. Anyways, we are few in numbers, but there's definitely room for collaborative work. Accessing text and typing text, we realize this is sort of the bigger problems that our users identified with. In terms of, again, mobile platforms, it's not the most readily available solution that exists in the world. And navigation is obviously one of the biggest ones. So that covers our work. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sumit. Are there any questions to Sumit's presentation? No? In this case, we're moving to our last but not least speaker. So our last speaker for today is Boaz Zilberman. Boaz is the co-founder and CEO of Project Ray in Israel. And to quote him, a veteran in high-tech technologies. So I'm sure we can benefit from his experience today. Boaz will talk about Ray, an end-to-end solution for online audiobooks and periodicals, services for the visually impaired. Boaz, you have the floor.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. Again, Boaz, I'm from Israel, and Project Ray is another startup, technology startup, and we look at us as a technology startup, not exactly a company addressing the blind and visually impaired people, although this is a major emphasis of our activity. And in my presentation, I will probably walk you through the hassles and the driving force behind building a startup company, especially in this very a neglected world of the space in the world, something that is social in nature, but require a lot of technology and advanced technology in order to provide something significant. So for us, the mobile device is actually a group of sensors that, using wisely, enable us to provide in software a lot of the capabilities that blind people are looking for, basically as a compensation for the lack of senses that they suffer from. And this is what actually attracted us as technology people when we approached this project and when we have started the work. And today, the Ray is a mobile device that is basically is hosted on a regular Android phone. This is an example for it. I will show it pressing the power key. I actually switch the mode from regular Android into our way of working. Without vision.
Back to home menu.
See, the concept or the idea is to really create a new user interface that is working on eye-free concept. You don't have to look at the screen. Everything is talking. And the relative movement of my...
library.
You see, I put my finger and move. And if I will put my finger in ear, I'll move to the same library. Direction. It will be the same thing, lifting it up.
Library.
And I go into this. So this is the interface that I created on top of the regular Android, and this serves the blind users very easily to do navigation, communication, social interaction, WhatsApp, Facebook, and so on, visual identification of object, and so on. Basically, my two predecessors talked about building a special hardware that provide one capability. We are doing it in software on top of an off-the-shelf device in software and provide all of the capabilities to the users. And one of the most important aspects that we push in it is remote assistance. Basically, the ability to help the blind person from remote, over the internet, over 3G connectivity, and basically not to leave the person helpless on his own. The beginning of it was starting by the Israeli Library for the Blind. The Israeli Library for the Blind is an organization dated about 60 years ago, and it became a very prominent establishment in Israel for some reasons, nobody can tell, but basically today everybody in Israel knows about it. I would say that any news broadcaster, TV anchor, and so on feel an obligation to contribute a few hours a day or a few hours a week to volunteer and to read books to blind people. I think that part of it is because any elderly person in Israel is liable to get those recording and audiobooks and use it. So it becomes something very big in Israel. They're running six state-of-the-art studios. They record over the around the clock with hundreds of books, periodicals, magazines in English, Hebrew, Arabic, Russian, and so on for the population. Now, looking at it, the problem of the library, they have two problems. One of them was digital right management. How to ensure that the digital content is not going to spread around to the general population, copyright. And the second are costs. It become very costly to actually deliver the books over CD-ROMs to users. It was done by postage and delivery, very expensive. It become a very a real burden on the budget of this organization. Assuming that in 2006, they actually migrate their production from cassette tape into CD-ROMs. So, you know, it's become very expensive. And they looked around and they looked for solution for digital distribution. And at that time, they approached my partner, that approached me and approached another guy. Three of us have been a very prominent technology people from the mobile space. And by definition, we have been pushed into doing what they are looking for on mobile devices. Now, the at that time, I was managing a startup company named Fring that was probably one of the biggest mobile voice over IP and messaging. In 2010, we have been had about 100 million users active on our network, very prominent startup company. That when we have started in 2006, people from the blind community approached me, asking me better create an accessible version of the application. For some reason, I have done it. And since 2006, I was able to move to actually follow up how the community is using general purpose smartphone with our version general purpose application. This was the reason that I was one of the people that was called into action to help the library. And basically, in terms of technology, it was very easy to create a mobile distribution of DRM content. Everybody is doing it today. You send file, picture, music, everything from everywhere to anywhere. This was not a problem. The problem that we discovered is the digital divide between the end user and the technology. Basically, the use of smartphone by blind people is extremely problematic. And the digital divide is the one that the aspect that we have tried to solve, and we try to find the solution. And through exploration, using the data that I gather from how people use Fring, the application, on their mobile phone, personal interviews, and so on, we came up with this patented technology of user interface that is eye-free. Behind it, there is also very simple. Basically, this is a menu. We have in it only two other screens. How to identify an item from a list, and then how to perform an action on this item. Through those three elements, we managed to do, again, navigation, communication, messaging, email, very simple and very easy to learn user interface. So today, with a few thousand customers, we identify that it is working. Now, it is working with the majority of the population. And here I would like to actually put something that is extremely important in this market of accessibility. Basically, out of the blind person, 80% of the blind are elderly people that lost their vision at age of 60 years and above. Those people are just like you and me. They don't have sensory compensation. Braille is something that they don't know how to read. It's very difficult to identify the letters in Braille, especially if you need to read something rapidly. They don't have the passion to learn. They are basically pushed back. They are discouraged by new technology. They end up sitting up in the couch looking at the TV, or basically listening to the TV. This is the reality. And this is 80% of the community. They are not able to actually work with the product from IMSS or from Kiora. It is not for them. And this is where we decided that we are going to focus. And like any startup, one of the reasons for us to exist is to break the rules. So this was the first rule that we break. We are going to actually target the people that nobody tried to address. And fortunately enough, after the idea, the other most important criteria or things that drive startup is funding. So we are lucky enough to be able to get the funding for the project. We got it from two major players. One of them is the Israeli chief scientist that is basically an incubation system by the Israeli government that encourages the development of new technology. Probably one of the reasons that there is such a dynamic startup atmosphere in Israel. And the other company is Qualcomm, which is a major company in the mobile space, probably the biggest player in the mobile space, that contribute funding for the project. We also got some help from Microsoft, from Google, and with all of this, we set up to build a product that originated from the library, become something bigger, because it become a complete phone, a complete mobile device and service for the blind, but the library service is still an important service capability in there. So what we have in terms of libraries? Today, we basically build a complete set of library-related services that is driven, and the end user will see it with our device or with a mobile, with a web version of it, but it basically consists of a player running on the device. It consists of a cloud service that actually can host audiobooks. It consists of many different layer of software that convert the many different protocols and let's say encryption services that are actually spread around this industry, which is very wide. And it enables people to get access to online books, to read description of it, to get the book to market as favorite for future download, to download it onto the device, to play it on the device with various speed change, and to listen to it, to mark items on the application, and so on. It also enables a book publisher to put books on the cloud and to provide it. Today we support, of course, the Israel Library for the Blind. We build a special library for Arabic books. We have a special library for Russian books, again, because in Israel there are a lot of Russian immigrants. We are integrated into LibriVox, which is the biggest US-based public domain library of books for which the IP has expired. So you can find there Gulliver and Duck of Monte Cristo and so on, but there are hundreds and thousands of books, quite good reading. And we work with Chris Radio, which is a US-based radio station devoted for the blind that read periodicals and so on. And the Library of Congress for the US, which is a library for blind in the US. We support books. We support periodicals. One of the nice things about periodicals is that you can subscribe to it, and the moment that we identify that there is a new volume of National Geographic, you immediately get it to your device, and like the paper on your doorstep every day or every month. It is working over there. The system is encrypted or non-encrypted. Access depends on the different requirement of the library that you work with. It can be through user credential, or it can be encrypted and DRM protected and marked and so on. It's a complete end-to-end solution that is available today and is part of our system. One of the lessons that we learned through this process that today, because the digital technology in this, let's say, drawn-back market is a layer of history and development. Nobody has the money to actually do a full conversion from one technology to another. It's a mirage of many protocols, many capabilities, many different conventions. And for this reason, we build a concept of Lego or middleware that enable us to basically, relatively easy, to move and serve any type of infrastructure that is available there. And we can relatively easy can actually go and provide a full system for any library or any language that is required. And this is the call for action. We are looking for partners. We are can do it in the US and Europe, but we know that most of the requirement and the biggest impact of such technology will be in the development country, in small countries in which there is not enough language supported material and we are there, we have the technology, and we can help. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Boaz. I would like to thank all the excellent speakers that came here today and shared their expertise and experiences with us. So we have heard from individual inventors, from startups, from companies, their experience and the challenges and opportunities that exist that are related, for instance, to the overlaps of the technology for the sighted and the aging population with the technologies that could facilitate lives of visually impaired persons. Then we have seen the trends from the through the findings of the landscape reports, which, by the way, is also accessible in a Word format with enhanced accessibility aspects in online. You can find the link on the infographic we have shared with you. We have also seen the challenges related to the cost and affordability of assistive devices and technologies, but also the opportunities for collaboration, foremost with academia that seems to be quite active in the area of assistive devices and technologies. And we hope that this event was very informative and useful for you. We're happy to continue working in this field, and we would like to further promote practical aspects of the implementation of the Marrakesh Treaty. And we hope that the report we shared and all the expertise and experiences can contribute towards that. Thank you very much.